Thank you, Josiah. Y'all excited about the omnidirectional dispersing system on those mugs? That's pretty awesome. I got all technical there for a minute. Well, I'm Pastor Jim. It's just an honor to be with you this morning. And more importantly, it's an honor to have our guest speaker with us this morning. Justin Evans was with us back in May when we kicked off our missions convention. We just took some time starting back in April of what does the Lord want us to do? What do we need to be doing? Tim talked about the search committee, and we don't want to mess this up. From day one of this whole transition, it's just been day by day, Lord, what do you want us to do, and how can we step into that? And I really felt, and the elders, the leaders, we really felt that putting missions as a priority for our church was a very important thing to do. So we took 4 weeks out of I think it was May 15th through, I think, the first week in June, where we just re-teed up missions as a church. And it's been a fantastic year. And I'm not just talking about fundraising. It's been a fantastic year just realigning our hearts with the mission that God has for His church, which is what? To go and make disciples of all nations. Amen? That's why we're here, is we're here to make disciples. And so, Justin, it's an honor to have you back with us. Come on up. Give it up for Justin, everybody.
Awesome. Thank you. It really is an honor to be back here, and I don't know about you, but I want some coffee right about now. That sounds great, and those mugs looked awesome. So, I also was actually really excited to hear about the Speed the Light. Minnesota is an amazing district to be a part of. And I could be wrong, but I think that Minnesota last year was the first time any district of youth have raised over $1 million, and to see now Minnesota has done it twice. Just fantastic. Shortly after, I just was thinking, I wasn't planning to say this, but I was thinking back to right after I got saved. I was 17 years old, I was in high school, and my grandmother had passed away. I was given a little bit of inheritance. Not much, but it was a little bit that I could save and put towards college. And then I learned about Speed the Light, and that was the first time that I learned the concept of giving to missions. And I wrote a check for $1,000 in high school to give to Speed the Light. And my church down in Indiana. So those of you who are part of the youth group, I have no idea where you are, who you are, but thank you for giving. Thank you for having a heart to invest your money into something beyond yourselves and seeing God's kingdom advance. It really is wonderful. Again, it's a lot of fun to be here. We were here in, it's actually just myself and my son were here in May. I think we're here in the third week in May. Jessica, she's right now, she's down with the kids, sharing with them in the kids' church. And Savannah, they're here with us today. So they're up there. So my wife, Jessica, daughter, Savannah, son, Toby. And it also is really a pleasure to be here on the day that the board has recommended to the congregation to hire Jim as the pastor here. Jim, you've really been an encouragement to us, and I don't just say that. I really feel like I've been able to connect with you, and I felt really encouraged by you and by the church as we've been on this process of getting to the missions field. So thank you so much for that. We really appreciate it. I want to show a video. This was a video that this is the first time I've been able to show this in a church. It was just completed last week. And this is a little promo video about the school we're going to be going to. We're going to Brussels, Belgium, where there is a Bible school, Continental Theological Seminary, that helps to train pastors and church leaders from all over Europe. It's over 30 nations, 34 nations this past year, represented among the student body. Really excited to go join, be a part of that work. So you get to be like our test subjects. I'm gonna gauge your appreciation of this video of whether we should continue showing it. So if you don't mind rolling that video for us.
This is an incredible environment. Every year we have students from at least 30 different nations come.
The goal of CTS is to raise up people, you know, biblical people and pastors, you know, singers, ministers, to go to other parts of the world and spread the gospel just as Christ has commanded us to do.
We are based in Europe, in Brussels, Belgium, which is actually known as the capital of Europe. And our students come from all over. For example, this year only, we have students coming from more than 34 countries.
And there's nowhere else that I can think of where your experience so many different cultures in such a small student body.
Spiritual life is what attracts me the most. The changing of your personality and character and letting God form you.
I really love CTS because we're a small community and it makes us like a family here.
30 countries, over 20 languages, all come together and they focus on what is the same about preaching the gospel in all those countries, in all those cultures.
All right, thank you. So what do you think? Should I show it again? Is it worth, you get the sense of what the school is about? I mean, this is really, it's about education. I mean, you say education, okay, I'm really passionate about education. It's about discipleship. It's about formation, that people get a hold of what God has called them to do, and we equip them and we help them on that path to see God's kingdom advance, because God's called each person uniquely, individually. And I feel so, I feel like I'm addicted to this idea of helping people along their journey to see them fulfill what God's called them to. It's really exciting. This is what we're going to be doing in Brussels, Belgium. So, now last time I was here, I mostly shared, as Pastor Bruce mentioned, my story of my testimony, how I came to faith. And if you weren't here, if you don't remember, just a brief synopsis. I wasn't raised in the church. I grew up in Indiana, and I got into a lot of trouble at a young age, got really into using drugs, alcohol, and was making some very poor choices. I didn't know if I would graduate high school even. And I had actually vandalized a particular church in Indianapolis, Indiana. My friends and I, we'd gone out, we vandalized this church. And what I didn't know was that some people in the church started to pray that whoever had vandalized that church would come back to that church and get saved. And it just so happened that a young girl who attended that church, who was involved in the youth group and was a part of that congregation, sat in front of me first hour in high school in physics class. And every day I was high and she would share with me about Jesus and how he loves me and how he has a purpose for me and my life can be so much more than what I'm currently experiencing. And eventually that led to me going to this church, not knowing that she attended the same church that I vandalized and all of this. And I ended up giving my heart to Jesus December 10th, 1997. So 19 years ago this past December. December 10th, 1997, gave my heart to Jesus. And then I found out about the church and how they'd been praying for me. And I told them what I had done. And they were like, wow, I can't believe you're back here. We're excited for what God's done for you. And this was, okay, late 90s. I mean, the whole Christian culture thing was new to me. It seemed like they had their own language, their own beliefs, way of doing things. And I was learning it, trying to be a part of this. And I noticed that a lot of the students, and maybe this was a 90s thing, but a lot of the students at this church were homeschooled or went to a private Christian high school. And they seem to be really passionate about that, about helping their kids. I'm not even going to touch that issue of what is appropriate. Parents, do whatever God has told you and led you to do what's right for your family. But I noticed this, and I went to a public high school, and I asked Jody, the girl who had brought me to church and had a very profound impact on my life. And I asked her, I said, Jody, how come you didn't go to a Christian high school? It seems like everyone else here in this Christian high in this youth group, everyone else in this church went to a Christian high school or they were homeschooled. And Jody said that when she was at the end of middle school, her parents gave her that choice. There was a well-known Christian high school nearby that she could have gone to. All of her friends went to, and her parents gave her that choice and said, "You're welcome to go to this school." But she prayed about it, and she said, I felt like God told me that I was supposed to go to the public high school because God was sending me there, and that I had a mission. the senior year of high school, she said, you know, I really questioned that a lot over the years of what was I doing here? But Justin, when you got saved, I saw my prayer was answered. Do you think it's possible that God loved me enough to send Jody to Pike High School so that I could know Jesus, the power of the cross and his resurrection? The text this morning is one that I'm sure you're very familiar with. Oftentimes, this is like one of the first Bible verses that people memorize from John chapter 3 and verse 16. I want to talk about the love of God as a motivation for missions this morning. And many of you know this verse by heart, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Now, I just want to get a little bit into the background of this. This comes in chapter 3, which in chapter 3 of John, we're reading this conversation that happened when a Pharisee by the name of Nicodemus, and Nicodemus later was counted among Jesus' followers. Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the middle of the night, and they have this conversation. And I encourage you to read all of chapter 3 of the Gospel of John. And Jesus, during the course of this conversation, he refers to a story from the Old Testament. Now, Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He would have known the story by heart. See, the Israelites, when they were still in the wilderness, God had rescued them out of Egypt, brought them to Mount Sinai, entered into a relationship with his people, and they were still in the wilderness, and they actually had been there for 40 years because of their unbelief, because of their lack of faith, and they didn't follow and obey God. They were in the wilderness for 40 years, and they were growing impatient, and then they not only spoke against Moses, but the text in Numbers, we read that they spoke against God as well. And God, in response to this, he punishes the people. He sends fiery or venomous snakes that would then bite the people, and they would get bit, and they would die. But the people cried out, God, please help us, save us, deliver us from this. And God, because he loved them, provided a way out. He actually instructed Moses to build and to have cast a serpent, a bronze snake, and put it up on a pole. It's kind of like an object lesson that he was doing for the people. And he said, you can go and you can look at this bronze snake that's on a pole. And when you see that, you see the punishment that you deserve for your sin. But you can look at that and believe and be healed. And now Jesus is referring to this story in chapter 3 of the Gospel of John. He was referring to the story to Nicodemus, and he says, do you remember that story? In the same way, the Son of Man, Jesus, I must be lifted up. And what's he talking about? I need to be lifted up and put on a cross. And when the world, when they see me, when they see me held up on that cross, what do they see? The punishment that they deserve. They deserve that punishment. And they see my own Son taking that punishment upon himself. Why? Because in the same way that God loved those Israelites, your ancestors, in the same way that he loved them, he loves the entire world. That he would actually give his own Son, even though he knew what that meant, that his Son would have to endure the cross. But it was love that motivated him. It was God's love that motivated him, his deep love for the entire world. Later in John's Gospel, we go through stories of miracles and teaching, and then we finally get to just right before Jesus is going to be enduring the cross itself. And he prays in chapter 17, this great, incredible prayer. And a part of that prayer, he says, Father, as you sent me into this world. Why did he send him into the world? Out of love. As you have sent me into the world, I have sent them. And it's out of the love for this world that God sent Jesus into the world, and it's the same love that motivates God to likewise send us. Now, this message is about missions, and this text actually has the word missions in it. Okay, now I'm going to geek out just for a second. I like etymologies. It's fun. I'm sorry. I'm going to put this on you. But you know where the word missions comes from? Latin word, missio. And what does missio mean? Have you ever heard of a missive? A letter that was sent out? This is the Latin from this word that appears twice in here. As you sent me, as you, in the Latin translation, as you, missio, as you have sent me into the world, I likewise, missio, I likewise have sent them. That's what missions is. God has sent his son, missions. God is sending us missions. Now, I'm not saying that you all need to quit your jobs this week, go out, get on an airplane, fly out. We all need to go be mission. It's not like that. But what is the business of this church? When we say we're a part of the people of God, what that means is that we are consciously embracing a number of different things. We are embracing, as the people of God, we become his church. We say we are embracing worship, that we will exalt God above everything else in this world and in our lives. We will exalt and lift him up. We will have compassion and care for this world. And we will be about his purpose, sending Jesus into the world and likewise sending us out into the world. Because, I mean, if we believe in a resurrected Jesus, like if you really believe in a resurrected Jesus, you know, if that didn't happen, if the resurrection was not true, Paul says what? That we should pity us more than anyone else. We're the world's biggest fools if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead. But if he was, and we don't share it, that's like the epitome of hate. If Jesus was really resurrected and we really believe it, but yet we don't share it with the world, that is hate. God loves the world enough to endure the cross and enough to send us out into the world. And we as the body all play a part in this, that as we go to jobs, we are about advancing his kingdom. As we interact with people sitting at the coffee shop, at the drinking Hope Coffee, we are about advancing his kingdom. As we talk with our relatives or people who don't know Jesus, we are about advancing his kingdom and sharing that love with the world. Why? Because that same power that raised him from the dead lives likewise in us. You know, I was called to missions when I came to North Central. So I'd been a Christian for less than a year. It's about 9 months, 8-9 months I'd been a Christian. I arrive up in Minnesota from Indiana, come to Minnesota, boy, it was cold. And I didn't know what I was going to do. I just knew I was really excited and I was getting this passion for sharing Jesus with the world. And my freshman year, I very clearly, distinctly remember God calling me into full-time missions work. Actually, I just have to say, my old professor, mentor, Bob Brenneman, is here, a longtime missionary in the Middle East. Thank you, Bob, for everything that you have done and the great impact you've had on my life. And then I finished at North Central, and I felt God specifically calling me into education, that I need to be a part of helping to train and raise up church leaders on the missions field. Along the way, I met Jessica, who also had a call to missions, and that was really kind of at the heart of our relationship of how we fell in love with each other, was sharing this common burden that we had to share Christ with the nations. And then after North Central, I go to more school. College is long, and graduate school is longer. And so I go out to Boston. I go to a seminary there. Had a great experience, and I was studying the Old Testament so that I could be an Old Testament professor and teach that overseas. And then I finish this. Jessica's pregnant with Toby at this time, 2008. We come back to Minnesota. I get licensed by the Minnesota District, licensed to preach Minnesota District. It's kind of like, okay, it's all coming together, but I needed a job. And we had a son, baby, on the way. So I took a job waiting tables. And here I am, licensed to preach, gone to Bible school, missions major, went to seminary, it was a good school, did well in my program, and I'm waiting tables. Not just like one or two nights, but that's my full-time job. And that's all I'm doing. And it was a difficult time. So here I am thinking, God, you've called me, you've sent me, and I can't, it seems like this is all I can do right now. And it was frustrating. Have you ever been in that place where you feel like God's called you to something, but you're stuck in this limbo, you're not doing what you feel like you're supposed to be doing? I want to share with you another story that happened during this time. You have a little context of what it is that I'm feeling as I'm there at a restaurant waiting table serving steaks, having people yell at me because their steak is too overcooked or something. Now, I worked in this restaurant. Now, there aren't a lot of Christians, at least in my experience. I've worked in a number of restaurants through college and seminary and a little bit afterwards. I didn't have too many Christian coworkers. A lot of people who wait tables, at least in my experience, professionally, like professional servers and staff, a lot of them were alcoholics and had a lot of very serious issues in their life. And I remember one time on a shift, it was between the lunch and the dinner shift, and we had a little bit of a break, and I'm sitting at a table, and I'm eating. And there's a guy that I've been working with, and I knew him, Steve, we'll just say his name was, sat down at the booth with me. Now, Steve was about as bad of an alcoholic as I'd ever known. Steve was also very open, homosexual. Not really just that, he was a sexual addict, to be honest. Very serious life-controlling problems. And I sit down with him, and we're talking. I mean, he was a nice guy. He's plenty fun, fine to talk with. And as we're talking, as we're sharing, he says, you know, I used to be a Christian. I said, really? Steve, can you tell me a little bit about that? I find out that he actually had gone to a Pentecostal church, did an internship at a Pentecostal church, thought that he was maybe called into ministry. But he never could, he had a hard time dealing with these homosexual tendencies that he felt. And he said, eventually, I just gave myself to it and went off the deep end, the stories that he told me, and became, again, about as bad of an alcoholic as I've ever personally known. And I remember wondering, why are you sharing this with me? But I said, Steve, you know God loves you. He says, yeah, I know all that truth. I said, well, okay, I'm going to be praying for you. Is that okay? Sure, you're welcome to pray for me. Okay, I'm going to be praying for you. Now, eventually, I was able to quit working in the restaurant. I was able to work at North Central full-time, and I was really appreciative of that. And we were a part of a church over in St. Louis Park at this time. We kind of lived on that side of the city. And one morning, Jessica and Toby and I were going into church, and I was getting there a little bit early because I was asked to help serve the communion that day with the pastor. So we got there a little bit early, and this was maybe 6 to 9 months after that conversation, or after I had left the restaurant. And I don't know how much earlier the conversation was. It's just a little foggy. But there, in the pew, three quarters of the way back, on the next to the aisle, was Steve. And I looked and I was like, what on earth are you doing here? And I go and I talk to him, Steve, what are you doing? He says, you know, I can't explain it. The last several months, I feel like God has just been really calling out to me, and I started reading my Bible again, and I started praying again. And then I knew I needed to get help, because I wanted to be free from all of my addictions, so that I just looked up a pastor, and it happened to be Pastor Bob, who was my pastor. And he'd been seeing him, he'd been being counseled, and he said, so I'm going to start coming to church now. And now, even to this day, he is still free and living for Jesus. He's free from all those addictions. I asked a question earlier. Could it possibly be that God loved me enough to send Jody to Pike High School so that I could know Jesus personally? Is it possible that God loved Steve enough to send me to be a server for those years that I didn't like? I didn't like that job. But God loves Steve enough, because God will do anything to have a relationship with you. He did. God will do anything to have a relationship with you, and God will do anything to have a relationship with the world. It is out of this deep and abiding love that God has for the whole world. And his love is still reaching out to millions of people who haven't heard. His love is still reaching out to millions of people who have not yet heard, but we worship a resurrected Jesus. And people are dying from the sickness of their sin. God's promised a way out. In Romans 10, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless there's that missions word again? How can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the gospel, those who bring the good news. Now, while we were in college, God began putting a burden on our heart for the people of Europe. We spent our honeymoon backpacking Europe. We spent 2 months backpacking Europe. It was loads of fun. And while we were on that trip, we contacted every missionary that we could find or local pastor that we could get in touch with to talk to them about what is ministry like, and we think God's calling us, and we just want to talk to you, want to hear from you. And actually, just yesterday, I attended the funeral of two missionaries that tragically passed away that we met while we were on our honeymoon. They're Minnesota missionaries and had been serving in Italy for over 30 years. And I attended that memorial service there for them. And they died. They died in mission. They died fulfilling what God had called them to do. Now, today in Europe, if you could jump ahead to the statistic here. Today in Europe, about 2.5% of the people have a personal relationship with Jesus. Now, there's no way we could really know this number for sure. No one knows this number exactly for sure. But this is based on some of the best experts in the world, our best guess, maybe a percent more, maybe a percent less. About 2.5% of people have a personal relationship with Jesus. And this is what we're going to be a part of to help to change, to see God's kingdom advance, because we believe that God wants to do something. And so we want to be a part of helping to train up new pastors, new church leaders from all over Europe. You saw the promo from that video. This is why that school is real exciting, because over 34 nations represented among that student body, over 20 languages represented among that student body. These are students coming from all over Europe, a little bit beyond. There's some students from Francophone African countries studying there as well. But mostly it's Europe, East, West, Central Europe, all coming together to study there so that then they could be sent back out to plant the church, to pastor, to be leaders, and to see God's kingdom advance. That's what we're excited to be a part of. 2.5%. I want to ask you a question. Do you think that this number can change? Do you believe that this number will change? Do you believe that God is not yet done with Europe? Would you mind just praying with me right now? Close your eyes, please. And do you really believe in the power of the resurrected Jesus that lives inside of us and is still calling people? Jesus, would you pray with me for Europe right now? Can we just take a moment right now and just intercede for Europe? God, I believe that you are not done with Europe. We believe that you still are calling people there and that your kingdom wants to advance into the darkness. God, I pray that you would raise up young leaders who will preach the gospel and who will reach out to the hurting, who will reach out to the refugees that have been flooding into Europe, God, and who are so desperate and are living in darkness. God, I pray that your light would shine in those dark places. God, for the secularists in Europe, for those people that live a life with no faith, no concept of God, I pray that they would meet people who know you personally and who will share and witness that love, God. I pray, as you have sent your Son into this world, out of your crazy, insane, passionate love for us, God, that love would likewise extend to the people of Europe. And God, that there would be a fire that would start in Brussels and that would spread across that whole continent. And that Europe would not only be a place where the light of the gospel shines clearly, but God, it would be a place where missionaries are sent out from Europe to shine your light around the world. We read in John's gospel that the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. God, your darkness will not overcome the light of the gospel. Prayer changes things. It really, really does. That is why I am a Christian, because a grandma in a church said, I'm going to pray for the person who vandalized our church that they would come back here and know Jesus. That's why I'm here, because prayer actually worked. It was like the hound of heaven just pursuing me, getting on me. I don't take any credit for the change in Steve's life. All I know is that I met him, I had a conversation with him, and I prayed for him. And I don't know who else was praying for him, but prayer does change things. You know what the Bible says in Psalm 97? It says, mountains melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. Mountains melt like wax. What a visual picture. So what do you think happens when the presence of God comes in contact with the hardened, stone-cold heart of sinners? Mountains melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. Likewise with the heart of sinners. Prayer does work. Prayer does change things. I encourage you to be a people of prayer and to pray for God's love to go out and for his kingdom to advance and for God in Christ reconciling the world to himself. We are, since we came here in May, I'm very, very honored that I can say we're actually now partnering with Real Life Church. You guys are supporting us on a monthly basis, and that thrills us. We're so excited to be partners with you. So many of you we know and are friends with, and we appreciate that very much. And we don't take that lightly. So just very sincerely, you are a part of, when you give to missions at Real Life Church, you're a part of seeing that darkness flee before God's kingdom as it advances. So thank you very much for that. As we are sending us to Continental Theological Seminary in Brussels, I'm going to go ahead and conclude here and invite, I think, Jim. Yep, you'll come up. After the service, we do have a table in the foyer. If you would come say hi, I would love to meet you personally. I'd love to shake your hand, give you a hug if you're into that thing. We do have a notebook where you can, we have a guest book you can sign if you want to share a message with us, or we also have where you can list your email. A lot of you signed up last time we were here. You can list your email, and we send out a newsletter approximately once a month, just to let you know what's going on, how you can be praying for us. We are currently at, you know, I've just realized I haven't even shared this yet. So we were more at the beginning stages of things when we visited in May. We're now at over 80% of our budget has been raised. Praise God, He is so faithful. So now when we get to 100%, we can get on an airplane. But this week, I'm going to try to go ahead and start the process for applying for our visas. And hopefully you can be praying for that would be a smooth process. Wouldn't get hung up in any paperwork or anything. But thank you so much, Jim. Please come. Appreciate it.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Justin. It's exciting seeing the results of what God is doing, isn't it? I want to go ahead and invite the ushers down. We're going to take a special offering, if that's okay. We just need to support these guys and help get them out the door and on the plane and over the sea, right? And so we're going to invite the ushers to come down. If you're here, if you weren't prepared to give, you didn't bring a check or didn't want to do cash, you can always give online. You can go to give.reallifechurch.net. You can do that right on your phone right now. And if you select, when you pick the category, if you pick deductible pass-through donations, I know it's real technical, but if you select that, every penny in this offering is going to go to Justin and Jessica and sending them on their way. Adam, will you throw up that Roman scripture one more time? There are people ready to hear, and it's our part of this, it's our privilege in this part of the story to be those who send. And this is us stepping into fulfilling this part of God's word. And so let's pray right now. And just like Pastor Bruce was talking about stewardship last week, missions, our participation in missions is a stewardship issue. So let's pray and let's just believe that God is going to speak to us and then He's going to provide the way. Amen. Jesus, thank you so much for your word. And what we know about your word more than anything is that it's anointed, it's powerful, and it doesn't return void. So right now, we are praying as hearers of the word that you would move on us to be doers of the word. And so what we ask you right now to do more than anything is open up the heavens, pour out your spirit, pour out your provision for Justin and Jessica. You would just do that in an amazing way through this church, because we want to step into your will for that part of their story. And everybody said amen. Amen. Well, we're so glad that you are with us. Please, please, please go out to the table. If you haven't met Justin and Jessica and the kids yet, please do so. These are amazing people. Get to know them. And as Justin shared, it's been awesome to be able to partner with them. Now we're supporting them on a monthly basis. I don't know if we've actually announced this, but we had a longtime Real Life Church World Changers. Do you remember Steve and Camille Lentz? They were serving in the Middle East as well. They've actually retired from missions work. They've been on the field for 30 years. I actually knew them when they were part of our church like this, when I was this tall, and they were at North Central Bible College. But they've retired, and so we were able to take what we were giving and supporting them and send that over to Justin and Jessica and pick them up, and it's just an awesome honor to partner with them. Sounds like we're good? Everybody good? Thank you for being here. I'm going to pray, close out the service, go to the table, meet Justin and Jessica. Jesus, right now, thank you for being here. Thank you for this, just the powerful presence of your spirit in this place. It was awesome to me just encounter you today. And what I believe, Lord, is that when we encounter your presence, we can't walk away unchanged. And so thank you for changing us today from the inside out. This has been worship. And from moment one to this moment and for our fellowship afterwards, this is all worship to you, because you are good and you never let us down. Amen? Amen. Have a great Sunday. We'll see you next week. If there's anyone who needs prayer for anything, if you came to church today looking for something, our elders, our staff, we would love to pray with you. We'll be down here in the front. But otherwise, God bless and have an awesome Sunday. Mm-hmm.